waited on the Lord to hear his gentle voice for guidance and direction where to go. I opened up my heart to know the perfect will of God. His will is all I need, his perfect will. As I spent so many hours in the presence of the Lord, I calmed down and began to hear his voice. The lovely voice of God, your tender voice revealing the mysteries of your will. At the crossroads of my life, no other voice compares, oh no. It's the sweetest sound my heart has ever heard, the lovely voice of God. The Spirit entered in to me when he spake to me. The words he spoke to me, they were spirit, they were life. The visions and dreams, oh how they turned my life around and brought direction for my ministry. As I rose up from my knees, there was a mantle now on me. I had found grace for mighty words, and I will never, ever be the same. The lovely voice of God, the tender voice revealing the mysteries of your of my life, no other voice compares, oh no. It's the sweetest sound my heart has ever heard, the lovely voice of God, the lovely voice of God, your tender voice revealing the mysteries of your
God. Amen. Well, tell two people we made it. Even though it was raining, we made it. Welcome to the first night of our weekend. And we made it through the rain. We're the ones who made it. Amen. And I know God has something to say to us. Please take your seats for a moment. As you know, we called this weekend, He Gave Gifts Unto Men. And periodically we have gifts of God coming through to our church. You know, the scripture says the Lord gave gifts unto men. He gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, which means when God loves you, he doesn't send you an iPad or an iPhone. He sends you a person. Amen. And it's wonderful to see the different gifts that God has for the body of Christ all over the world. And tonight we are blessed to have one of God's choicest gifts. And somebody, you know. All right. Listen. You're getting excited too early. Sit down. Now, somebody who we can confidently say is a father in the faith. And when I heard he had agreed to come, I was excited. And after I met him, I got more excited. And then since I sat down and did a little Bible study with him, I'm even more excited. And he's the Bible economist. And he's my favorite type of Pentecostal preacher because he's a former Baptist, so he's a Baptecostal, which means he loves the Word. And we are going to have a feast in the Word of God today. And sometimes it's better when it rains because then it's only the faithful who come. So tell two people, God had something for you tonight. Amen. And he's been preaching the gospel longer than you've been alive. He's 87 years young. And God has used him to touch so many people all over the world. The last time he was in Ghana was how many years ago, Pastor Evan? 1987. And my friend Pastor Eben is here and his wife. Do you want to just stand and give a wave? Now, his father was just starting out in the ministry in 1988. And Pastor Avanzini came to Kumasi with Maurice Cerullo. And his father, it's a great testimony. His father was so touched by the teachings of Dr. Avanzini. He went for it. He gave an offering that became the foundation for the ministry they have today. And so when his dad heard that Brother Avanzini was coming, he said, you better go there and honor the man of God for what he was to us. So your story is the same. You're also going to say, the gift of God came to my church. I heard what the Holy Spirit had for me. And my life will never be the same again. And sit down. I'm not done. Give me my time. This is my moment. And I spoke to my dad 2 days ago. And he said, you know, you're just blessed because these were people we watched from afar. And these were people that we were blessed from afar. And you are blessed to be able to have such a choice gift and a choice anointing here at the First Love Church. And so now you can stand and shout. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege and my honor right here at the First Love Church to bring to the stage God's man, the teacher, the Bible economist, Brother John Avanzini. Give God praise. Give him a First Love welcome. As we welcome Brother John Avanzini. Amen.
Wow. Glory to God. Wow. Wow. Let me look at you a moment. Now, I want you to help me get started, right? Now, in Texas, we don't say choppy little words. We string our words out a little bit. And I want you to tell the person near to you that Brother John thinks they look real nice, but not real choppy, but real nice. Brother John thinks you look real nice. Yes, yes. Oh, yes. Praise God. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. My grandson, Jason, is with me. Amen. He's married, so settle down. And I'm going to ask Jason to come up and share a few words with you. You'll be hearing more from Jason in years to come. Amen? Jason.
Wow, glory be to God. Church, the half has not been told of what's going on here in Accra. The half has not been told about what God is doing. I'm so overwhelmed. Praise God. This is going to be your weekend of breakthrough. This is going to be the weekend that everything shifts in your life. Houses, spouses, careers, new jobs. It shifts now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, some people were still sitting down. They say, oh, Jason, you're just trying to get our hopes up. The Bible says faith is the substance of things hoped for. So if your hopes aren't up, you don't have any. What does your faith have to work with? Hallelujah. Okay, be seated, be seated, be seated. I share with you a verse here. In Ecclesiastes chapter 11, verse 3, it says, when the clouds are full, it's going to rain. And it says, if the tree falls toward the south, toward the north, and the place where the tree falleth, there it shall be. You're probably wondering what that has to do with you. Well, there's actually a great truth here. And it starts with the fact that trees don't just fall in any direction. They fall on purpose in a direction. See, cutting down trees in Texas, I've cut down a few growing up in Texas. And one of the things that you have to learn is how to get the tree to fall in the direction you want it to go. So you have to decide where you want it to land before you start making chops at the tree. Because you don't want it to fall on a house, you don't want it to fall on the road, right? Am I making sense? So they teach you what you have to do is put notches into the tree so that when it starts to fall, it will move in that direction. Because once a tree starts falling, there's no getting it to change direction. And once it starts falling, good news, if it's going the right way, it's going to happen quickly. Okay, here's the parallel. A lot of us look at our lives and we have a place that we want our lives to land. It's in a place of being blessed. It's in a place of having health and wealth and being in a situation where we are experiencing the fullness that God has made available to us. Amen? We maybe have that picture of where we want our life to land, but we don't consider all the notches in the tree of our life that will get us moving in that direction. You can want it to fall over here, but if you're not putting those notches into the tree, you could end up falling into a place of failure, falling into a place of compromise, falling into a place that is less than the fullness of God. See, one of the greatest notches in the tree of your life has everything to do with your financial decisions.
Yes.
Oh, now it's quiet. See, what you decide to do with your money or what you decide to do with the finances God has entrusted with you has everything to do with the way that your life will lay out. I'm talking about tithes, I'm talking about sowing, and I'm talking about even the opportunity that we have tonight. This weekend is a God-ordained weekend. It's a divine appointment. The fact that everything tried to stop it from happening and you're still here speaks of the breakthrough, of the volume of the breakthrough that's heading your way. So praise God that we have this opportunity to be here with my grandfather. Now, I'll leave you with this. Please don't miss this opportunity. Please don't miss this opportunity. I'll give you a definition of the word poor. Say poor.
Poor.
Oof. Don't like it. P-O-O-R. Passing over opportunity repeatedly. Passing over opportunities repeatedly. Poor. Don't pass over. Don't miss your opportunity this evening and this weekend. Would you help me welcome once again my grandfather, Brother John Abzini.
Woo!
Thank you, Jason. Leave this here. Let me once again take a look at you, get oriented. Many are here in this room right now that in days to come will handle great wealth. One of the things, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord, be seated. One of the things that we have to grasp if we're going to move into the prosperity of God is you have to understand that there is no shortage of money. There's no shortage of money. Now, it looks like a shortage The problem is the wrong people have the money. As long as the wicked have it, it's going to look like a shortage. But as the children of God put to work what God has in His Word, He has a plan to put you into exceedingly abundantly above all you can ask or think. It's a simple plan. It has to do with trusting Him. Shouldn't be hard for Christians, but some reason it is. They quickly believe that God will save their soul, and they put their whole future in His hands with their soul, but they don't think He can handle the financial things. You have to be very careful, because it's the soulish part of you that will draw away and thinking, this is a practical matter. There's nothing more practical than God's love for you and His concern for you and Him bringing you into the good life. I thank God for this great ministry that you're a part of. It's one of the wonders of the world. One of the wonders of the world. And I can't get over this, even as I hear it time and again, how big this ministry is, how powerful it is, how many people it touches. As I'm here now, I'm understanding it's even larger than what I was told. And it is a blessed nation that has the anointing that this ministry has and will shed it upon people. I'm just blessed to be here and be in your presence. My mind goes back to the early years when I came here, when no one really heard much about biblical economics. It was in Aba, Nigeria, not too far from here, that God came into my room and began to open to me the Word of God in relation to finances. Since that time, when I got into the anointing of biblical economics, there was one or two books on the subject. Now I've written 52 books on the subject. I'm writing right now, my grandson and I are writing together one, on the Abrahamic tithe. There's a movement afoot, and thank God it's not strong here, but in some parts of the world they've stopped the tithe almost from happening in the church. But God still has a purpose for the tithe. In time, we'll probably have a chance to teach some of this, but you're going to find that God has had a sharing of the increase. Every time increase comes to a human being, God says, I want a share of it, all the way from the garden into the New Jerusalem, and they're still bringing wealth into that place. You will be in a don't think you're going to heaven and sit on a cloud. You'll have a continuing commerce that will be going on as we go forth and bring a whole new existence to this universe. I look at it now and it's pretty beat up. And you see places where there's no life, where there's a darkness, and where there's a lot of nothingness. But after the great war of the angels, when they fought, they decimated the whole universe with their battle. And now then, God has started over on planet Earth. This blue marble that sits out there, and it will be one day that there are millions upon billions of people in that new Jerusalem that we're going to. Now, one of the things you have to realize is we get the underdog feeling. We get that underdog feeling whenever we're here on planet Earth as Christians. But hear me, there's more of us than there is of them. There's more of us than there is of them. Now, let me explain that to you. See, when a sinner dies, he goes to God's prison house. But when a saint dies, they go into the presence of the Lord. They're lifted up into the body of Christ. And at any given moment, the entire 2,000 years of people that have gotten saved could be back on this planet. Are you grasping what I just said? Well, God has great plans for you. You are just about that right age to see the absolute best of God take place in your life. You know, I find this, that when it gets darkest is when God operates the greatest. I notice when I go, and my wife has passed now, but I would go many times to buy jewelry for her, buy diamonds. And yet God doesn't mind you having diamonds. I don't think he's happy with the wicked having them, but you can have them. But I know they would show a black background, total dark. They would use velvet where there was no reflection, just to show off the beauty of it. And God is getting ready to show off his jewels. He's getting ready to show you off to the world a new breed of human being. New creatures in Christ Jesus. And God's getting ready to move in a whole new way in your nation. All of this that you see now with this shortage in finances, I come from Semarang, Indonesia, and I just take a few minutes to get you oriented on some of the things that are on my mind. Semarang, Indonesia, we went there 20 years ago, and we started teaching biblical economics. And there was a group of people just like you that came together, young folks that came together and said, we're going to believe this thing, and we're going to make it work. And there is such a move of tithing and offerings. And we built one place, a $27 million building, with one offering. The money came in. One offering, $27 million came in. Now, what I'm trying to say to you is this. You are a new breed on planet Earth. It's not going to be the way it was for your parents. It's going to be a new day. And no matter what they say about the poverty in your nation, it will one day be one of the rich nations of Africa. Because when you tithe and give offerings, and enough people do it, it draws wealth into a community. Because now when we went back to Semarang, beautiful new hotels, beautiful restaurants from one place to the other. Just during the COVID time, God moved that quick. Child of God, please know this. Stay tight with God. Don't play games with your money. Keep it in God's house. God will multiply it 30-fold, 60-fold, and even 100-fold. I want to speak to you tonight on the subject of reward motivation, reward motivated. Now, there comes a great frown from the theological community if you talk about being reward motivated. They want you to feel that if you do something for God, you just do it because you love him. And we do things for God because we love him. But after I found that he will pay you, he'll bless you, he'll multiply 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold, he'll multiply it back to you, I got more enthusiastic about working for him. Why? Because he put in me that reward motivation. If you have a reward for me, I will do a harder job of trying to get things done. And God operates in reward motivation. Now, it's 80 times the word reward appears in your King James Bible. And it was spoken, the most spoken one, the one that spoke it more than anyone else, was Jesus himself. 17 times Jesus talks about reward. And you're going to find that most of the things that people complain about when you teach on biblical economics are things that Jesus established. When I teach the hundredfold, I get lots of problems. People rise up. You shouldn't preach the hundredfold. That's for another day. No, Jesus established that. It wasn't Abraham. It wasn't Isaac. It wasn't Jacob. It was Jesus that spoke of the hundredfold. You go to Mark and you'll find it there that he began that teaching right there in that area. Now, this is what you're going to find. And Paul, by the way, Paul, 12 times Paul spoke the word reward. And then, by the way, if you plan to worship God, you're going to have to be reward-oriented, because it says in Hebrews 11:6, but without faith it is impossible to please him, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. That's not my saying. See, people would say, oh, Brother John will tell you all kind of things that aren't in the Bible. I will not leave the Bible. I'll deal with 22 verses tonight as I talk with you. And we'll see line upon line, precept upon precept. Our God is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Now, one of the areas of scripture that you should always keep ready in your mind and keep it where you can get to it in your Bible is Deuteronomy 28. Because in Deuteronomy 28, God starts talking about the reward that he has for you. And over there you'll find in Deuteronomy 28, the second verse, and all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee. Now, can you imagine that? Not just blessings coming to you, but they're going to overtake you. They're going to run you down and see to it that you're blessed. Now, you say, Brother John, that's not happening to me. Maybe you're not believing it, because what you believe is what comes to you. What you doubt never comes to you. Are you grasping what I'm saying? And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Blessed shalt thou be in the city. Third verse. And blessed shalt thou be in the field. Fifth verse. Blessed shall be in the basket and in the store. Let me clarify that to you. The basket is the money that you use for your daily life. But your store is your savings account. Your savings account. Now, all the time that I was a Baptist preacher, and I pastored one of the larger Baptist churches in America, but I never did hear anything about God wanting me to have a savings account. But you find here, when you see this thing in the basket, that's the money that it takes to live by day. But the store is your storehouse. God wants you to have a bank account. He wants you to have a savings account, not just a bank account, a savings account. Because let me say this, you're young, and if you're going to be the good man or a good woman, the Bible says a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children, and you can't do that without a savings account. Are you grasping this? Blessed shalt thou be when thou cometh in. You're going to be blessed at home. Blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out. You're going to be blessed in your vocation. The Lord shall cause thine enemies that rise against thee to be smitten before thy face. They shall come out against thee one way and flee before thee seven ways. Now get this eighth verse. Watch this. The Lord shall command the blessing upon thee in thy storehouse. God said, I will command the blessings into your savings account. I will command it to go into your savings account. But it cannot happen if you don't believe it. It cannot happen if you don't prepare for it. You have to make up your mind that I am going to be a person of substance. I will not settle for less. God is ready to put money in my bank account. So I have to start being sure that my heaven is open. I tithe. And child of God, let me tell you now, if you're not tithing, you are abusing yourself. You're guilty of self-abuse if you're not tithing, because that tithe opens heaven. And who would not want to live under an open heaven? Who would not want to live under the under the spout where the glory comes out? Oh, are you learning anything? And look what he says. He shall command the blessing upon thee in the storehouse. God wants you to have a savings account, and he wants it to be fat. He wants you to have a fat savings account. Oh, hallelujah. I want a fat savings account. Amen. I don't want a little skinny savings account. I want a fat savings account. Are you learning anything? Look at that 11th verse. My Lord, look at this. And the Lord shall make thee plenteous in goods. Plenteous in goods. See, right now, if you're not careful, you will drift into this life of not having plenty of goods. You will ride by these. Have you have them here where you have storage places where you can get a storage locker to keep things in? Well, you'll ride right by those and you'll never know what they're for. But you're going to have so much if you'll do what God says, that they'll be exceeding abundantly above all you can ask or think. You'll be using storehouses. For instance, I have one of my automobiles now. I can't take it on my property. I don't have place to put it. I'm having to put a garage in for my six spaces for my new, for my cars that I'm going to be setting up. I said, Brother John, does God want you to have good cars? Listen, Jesus insisted on a new car. Now, just because I say it doesn't make it so. But he said, get me a donkey and get me one that no one has ever sat on before. Oh, hallelujah. Look out, devil. Look out. You know, God used, you like that? I like that new car smell, don't you? Jesus did too. He said, I don't want a donkey that other people have been sitting on. I want a fresh donkey. Amen. Well, let's move a little further. Strange as it may seem, God uses reward motivation to win the lost. Now, I remember as a young man when I first heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. I was a bricklayer. I was a laboring kind of guy. I didn't get a lot of education. I was a laboring guy. And whenever I was out on the job one day, and they were throwing rocks we were working on waterfront houses, and there was a distance between the two little islands, and they were throwing rocks. And so I was out there, and there was a guy there named Lester Miller. I said, "Lester, I'll bet you $50 I can throw the rock further than you can." He said, "I don't gamble, not with money." I said, "Well, what do you gamble with?" He said, "Well, if I throw it further than you, you come to church with me Sunday. And if you throw it further than me, I'll go wherever you go on Sunday." So I said, "Sure, old man, you're on." And I'm telling you right now, I had not read the Bible, but God has a way with rocks. You remember what happened to Goliath? Whew, I mean, that rock went. And Lester reached back and threw, and the Holy Ghost got under that rock. And it traveled so far. I thought, well, here I am at church with the guy. I lost a bet and went to church. But that night, they preached about hell. And they preached hell so hot that people were just antsy. And the reward was, you can go to hell or you can go to heaven. And I said, "Put me down for heaven." And I got saved that night. I got saved that night. Glory to God. I wouldn't have got saved. I didn't love God. I had no love for God whatsoever. It wasn't the love that drew me to God. It was the reward that drew me to God. Whew, you better know our God is a rewarder of those that diligently seek Him. Are you learning anything? Well, now here's something that most people don't know. And most people don't believe that it's true until they see it, and then they kind of wonder if maybe there's a misprint or something. But the backslider, you know what a backslider is? Yes, do you? Well, did you know that God has a way of bringing the backslider back that most preachers don't even know about? Well, in Job 22:23, it says, "If thou return to the Almighty," he says, "come on back, backslider, thou shalt be built up. You're going to put iniquity far from your tabernacles. Come on home, backslider. Now watch what you get. Then shalt thou lay up gold as dust, and the gold of Ophir as the stones of the brook. Yea, the Almighty shall be thy defense. You're going to have plenty of silver. Backslider, come on home. God wants to bless you." Whoop, whoop. Are you getting that? Oh, my goodness. So, you know, we have such strange rules for the backslider. If you come back, you won't lead in prayer. If you come back now, you'll have to sit kind of off to one side. Just get used to. Man, God says, "Come on in, backslider." Do you know what it means to have gold like dust? Have you ever wondered about that verse of scripture? Have you ever noticed the one thing that always is there is dust? You can take that piano right there and just clean it as tight as you want. But any given time, you can walk by there and just pick you up a little dust. Whew. Oh, got an insurance bill to pay. Whew. Got a little dust. God will keep a flow of that gold dust coming into your life until finally He turns it into stones, gold like the stones of the brook at Ophrah. God wants to bless you. Backslider, this is the place to come. Don't go down to the honky-tonk. Get in the house of God. God will take and bless you if you'll come in. Amen. Are you learning anything at all? Woo! My God is a mighty God. Now, one of the things that upsets people is when you talk about giving to God so that you can get. They say you never give to God expecting anything back. If you do that, you will get nothing back. But watch with me now. Luke 6:38, and it says, "Give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over." So one of the things that we find out is if you want to receive something, you give it. Ephesians 6:8 says, whatever good thing you cause to happen for anybody else, God will cause that same thing to happen to you. If you want friends, the Bible says be friendly. Anything you want, if you'll put it out, start putting it out, God will start pouring it back out on top of you. But now please know, if you're not expecting it, it won't happen. Now I'll deal with that at another time. But expectation is paramount. It's necessary for manifestation. But it's another message. But not only does God state that he wants to bless you financially so that you can get, he also says that he wants you to expect it. Be in expectation. Because many times we just come to church and we're here. Oh, look, so-and-so. Isn't that wonderful? He got blessed. He got a new car. Isn't that nice? Oh, and they're getting a new home. So wonderful. Listen, I don't want to be left out on that stuff. But the way that you have to do it is you have to be line upon line and precept upon precept. And if you're not tithing and if you're not giving offerings, it's not going to be long until you're going to be an observer of the blessings in other people's lives instead of having it in your own life. Are you learning? Now watch something with me here, and I drop this quickly. I'll give this to you. So, can we get Malachi 3:10, King James, on the board somewhere? Malachi 3:10. Yeah, okay. Bring you all the tithes into the storehouse, that there shall be in the storehouse that there may be meat in my house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. This sounds good? It's not what it says. Seven of the last words are all in italics. They don't appear in the original. The original says that there shall not pour you out a blessing. That not enough is all it says. That's not enough just to bring in the tithe. He says, I'll pour you out a blessing, but that's not enough. Why? Because just previous to that, he reported two robberies. He said, you've robbed me in tithes and offerings. And then he says, bring the tithe, but that's not enough, because the tithe opens the windows of heaven and the offering makes the measure that God can use to bless you back through those windows. Now, what most of us do is this. We're good to tithe, and then we give offerings with a teaspoon. And we strap God's hand, we strap a teaspoon in God's hand, and now he has to bless us with a teaspoon, because with whatever measure you meet with all, it'll be measured to you again. Oh, if you want shovel loads, then you've got to give with a shovel those offerings. And if you want a truckload, you got to run truckloads in if God's going to run truckloads out. These are such simple things. Listen, I would have already been dead today if I had not found out about these things. I was a bricklayer. I would have gout in my feet now. I'd have knots that big on my feet if I was alive. I lived a rough vocation I had. People didn't live very long with it. But in that, somewhere along the line, when I got into the house of God, I got out of the standard issue of Christianity, and I got into this 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold life. I got into this fact that God wanted me to prosper, that he wanted rich people in the community, and he wanted me to be one of them. Church, I probably was one of the people that would never amount to anything. I had no education to speak of. I had a trade is all I had, and it was a trade that would put me in the grave early, but I found out about God. And then someone slipped up and let me find out about seed time and harvest and find out about giving and receiving. And I had, at first, it's kind of strange. You think, my Lord, I can't hardly make it myself. But that's the time that your offerings are worth the most. When you're in shortage, God, and I'm going to teach on this. I'll teach on this on Sunday. But when you're in shortage, your money is much more valuable to God, because remember the woman with the two little mites? Man, I mean, what was, and then by the way, she wanted something, remember? It said that she of her want did cast in all that she had, all of her living. What does a widow woman want? What does a widow woman want? Usually someone hollers out, a husband! And then I had another one jump up usually and say, a rich husband! Well, God's ready to meet you. If you have that in your mind that I am going to go from glory unto glory, I'm going to have exceedingly abundantly above all I ask or think, as long as your purpose for the money is proper. You follow? Because these things will work, but if your purpose isn't right, it'll get stopped up and quit working. Whew, are you learning anything? God puts no limit on how much you can have. You can be seated again. Ephesians 3 and 20 says, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly, and that means abundantly, that means beyond measure, above all that we ask or think, more than you can even imagine in your wildest dream. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can ask or think, according to the power that worketh in thee. And then please know this. You are worthy of it. You are a royal ambassador. You are a king and a priest. If you don't understand who you are, no one in the spirit world is coming to help you to understand it. You're going to have to know that you are a king. You're going to have to know that you're a priest. You're going to have to know that you're a royal ambassador. You're going to have to know that you're mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. You're going to have to know that you're the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. Woo, I hope you're getting this. Because Romans 8:32, listen to this. Don't let this out of your mind. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? If he gave us Jesus, he's not going to say no to you having a home. He's not going to say no to you having proper transportation. He's not going to say no to you having a vacation. Grasp these things. Don't listen to what the rich wicked have to say about you, because they want you subjugated. They want you down below them. But God says you are the head and not the tail. You are above and not beneath. You're mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. You are somebody. And then, you know, people tell me, Brother John, is that all you talk about? Well, for 40 plus years, I have not preached anything else except that God wants to prosper his children. And they say, it's too much. You shouldn't do that. But the Bible is on my side. Listen, Psalm 35:27. Let them shout for joy and be glad that favor my righteous cause. Yea, let them say continually, let the Lord be magnified with his pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. God says, talk about it all the time. All the time talk about it. Oh, my goodness. You're an easy crowd to talk to. God wants prosperity taught continually, not occasionally. Some of the churches in my country, they have financial February. They talk about finances only in February. But what about the people that get saved in March and April and May and June? They got to wait a whole year before they find out that God wants them blessed. It should be going out continually. Ooh, hallelujah. Ooh. Somebody say, look out, devil. Woo! Amen, amen, amen. You know, God approves of his children having precious stones and jewelry. Oh, my wife. She's passed now. She's in heaven now. But I used to tell her, I'd say, baby, you're my Christmas tree. Let daddy, I said, let daddy decorate you. Look out, devil. Look out, devil. You know, in the Garden of Eden, when God was giving his orientation to Adam and Eve, He didn't tell them where the bathrooms were. He didn't tell them where the lounge was. Didn't tell them where the bedrooms were. He said, here, I'm going to show you where things are. 10th verse, and a river went out of Eden and watered the garden. From thence it was parted because and came and became into four heads. The name of the first was Pison, which is which encompasses the whole land of Hibla, where there is gold. Oh, God likes gold. God likes gold. He said, get this pavement out of here and move some gold in here. We'll have golden streets. And he said, oh, I thank you for the mahogany, but I won't want a mahogany altar. I want a solid gold altar. And I want gold candlesticks. Amen. And then, by the way, the last time Jesus was seen in public, he had on a golden girdle. Woo! And it was not electroplated. It was the real thing. Glory to God. Wow. Now, the first miracle Jesus performed, he didn't go down to the hospital. He didn't go down to the jail. He went to a party. Jesus liked to party. He liked partying. He liked to party. Yes, he did. Well, you have his nature. Why do you think you like parties? He likes parties. Anyway, he's now in, we're in John 2, 1 through 10, Holmes' translation. It says, on the third day, a wedding took place in Cana of Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding as well. When the wine ran out, Jesus' mother told him, they don't have any wine. The next, Jesus says, what has this concern of yours to do with me, woman? Jesus asked, my hour is not yet come. Do whatever he tells you, Jesus' mother says. Now there were six stone water pots had been set for the Jews' purification. Now watch this. Jesus had a sense of humor. He's got these big water pots, but what are they used for? They're used for washing hands. It's hand washing water. They might even wash a few dishes in it. But he likes to have a good time. Now, he says, now six stone water jars had been set there for the Jews' purification. Each contained 30 gallons. Fill the jars with water, Jesus told them. So they filled them to the brim. Then he said unto them, now draw some out and take it to the chief servants. And they did. When the chief servant tasted the water, after it had become wine, he did not know where it came from. That's the part I like. He didn't know where it came from. But those servants that were bringing it, they knew. They knew. But they knew Jesus because he was invited to that feast. He wasn't a stranger there. They knew that something good was about to happen. Have you ever said that something good is about to happen? Say that. Just listen to it how it sounds. Something good is about to happen. Oh, that was Dr. Oral Roberts' main statement. Something good is about to happen. I love it. But anyway, now it says, everybody set out the fine wine first. And he called the groom and told him, everybody set out the fine wine first. And after people drink freely and the inferior. But you have kept the fine wine until now. Child of God, please know this. That was 180 gallons of wine. 180 gallons of wine. He's come to the party and he brings 180 gallons of wine. And not only that, but listen, it was fine wine. So the miracle had to transfer it into wine, the water, but then it also had to back it up in time because it takes time to have fine wine. And I'm telling you right now, that was some party that day. That party went on and on and on. But think about this. The wine auctions in Geneva, a bottle this year sold for $233,000 for one bottle. The highest ever was $550 for one bottle at that Geneva wine fountain. But let me tell you what. If we could come up with just one bottle of that stuff Jesus made, how much? 1 million, 2 million, 5 million, 10 million. Oh, when Jesus does something, he does it up fine. He does it up fine. And listen, it's not some angel that's in charge of your life. It's not some cherubim that's seeing about you, but it's the Son of God. It's God himself. You are riding in the front seat with your Savior. Oh, child of God, get this. When you go out in these streets, they don't know who you are. But you have to know who you are. You have to know who you are. Because no one is going to come tell you who you are. But you, if you know who you are, you will not be stopped. I'm talking to people that are about to come millionaires. And please know, I get in trouble now. Okay, I'm in trouble. They say, Brother John, you got to take it a little easy about the finances. Don't get everybody excited. But get saved. Oh, come to visitation. Oh, come on, do this. Get involved in this. Get baptized. Get active. And get filled with the Holy Ghost. Oh, come on tonight. We're having a Holy Ghost meeting. And then you bring prosperity. Say, oh, easy, easy, easy. No, I don't want it easy. When I got it, I wanted a load of it. I wanted things to change fast. I wanted to get out of the old junk car. I wanted to get out of the sloppy house I was in. I wanted to get into worn out secondhand clothes. I wanted some new clothes. Glory to God. If you know who you are, you will insist on that. God will bring it. God will bring it. But remember this. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then things start being added. By the way, let's deal with that a minute. The Bible says he will multiply your seed for sowing and that he will add to you for your assets. Are you picking what I'm saying? You got to understand this. When you get in God's economy, it's going to come to you quickly. Money will start moving toward you. And if you start multiplying your assets, you'll stop the whole thing. If you will see to it that you are in the process of reinvesting finances into the kingdom of God, they'll start moving up. Things will get better. Clothes will get better. The ride will get better. The street address will get better. Things will keep getting better and better because God wants you to be a steward. He doesn't want you to take your money and do this. He says he'll give you money. He'll put money in your hands. He'll see to it that you have opportunities. But you have to remember this. If you short stop putting finances into the kingdom of God, if you all of a sudden say, look, I'm going to start multiplying my assets and I'm just going to add to my giving, you're going to make a big, big mistake. A big mistake. Multiply your giving. Let it multiply. And God will keep up. He will not owe any man anything. There'll be more than enough for you. Are you getting that? Now, let's move a little bit further here. What do we got now? God doesn't mind his children keeping luxuries. You know, you get a mistake, you go into Jericho, and all of that belonged to God in Jericho. But see, that was the tithe. They were coming into the land. That was the tithe for the land. He was giving them the tithe. So first they tithe. They brought all of Jericho together, and that was the tithe. And now they were going in to take what belongs to them. Grasp that. Get a hold of that, because you sometimes get to thinking God doesn't want you to keep that. You think God? You were telling me when you went to Bible college, you had a beautiful purse, a designer purse that minister's wife gave to you, and then they turn around. And the professor says, you should sell that purse and give it to the Lord. And I love your mind. You have a great mind. Because she told that professor, said, I saw your Lexus outside. Sell your Lexus and then I'll sell my purse. Glory to God. There's always somebody knows what to do with your money. It's your money. You do what God tells you to do with it. Kura habababa. Oh, hallelujah. All right. Exodus 12, 35, 36, God's Word translation. The Israelites did what Moses had told them, and ask the Egyptians for gold and silver, jewels, and for clothes. The Lord made the Egyptians generous to the people, and they gave them what they asked for. So the Israelites stripped the Egyptians of their wealth, stripped them of their wealth. I'm telling you, the Egyptians were standing out on the porch in their underpants watching Israel go out of town. They took everything they had from them. Child of God, God wants you to have succeeding abundantly above all you can ask or think. Now, I'm telling you that right now. But when you get out there in the nasty now, they're not going to tell you that. You're going to have to be telling yourself that. You're going to have to be telling yourself that. I am a child of God. I am a king. I am a priest. I am more than an overcomer. I am mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. That conversation's got to go on inside of you or they'll defeat you. They'll defeat you. Are you learning anything? Yeah. By the way, when they went on that journey, you want to see a miracle? Here's the miracle. Deuteronomy 29:5. Deuteronomy 29:5. I have led you 40 years in the wilderness. Your clothes are not waxed old upon you, and thy shoes is not waxed old upon thy foot. Can you hear that? I mean, as they went, their shoes never wore out. Now, you hadn't seen it yet, but little kids with shoes this big, they took off, and as their feet grew, their shoes grew. I mean, God knows how to bless his people. Okay, here's another good one here. 2 Chronicles 20:22-25. There was a battle with Ammon and Moab, and God moved out front, and not a blow was struck by Israel, but they won the battle. The 22nd verse, and when they began to sing and praise, the Lord set ambushments against the children of Ammon, Moab, and Seir, which were come against Judah, and they were smitten. Now watch, 25th verse. And when Jehoshaphat and his people came to take away the spoils of them, they found among them in abundance both riches with the dead bodies and precious jewels, which they stripped off for themselves more than they could carry away. And they were 3 days in gathering all the spoils. It was so much. God does not want you in any kind of shortage. He wants you to have exceeding abundantly above all you can ask or think. But the fat cats, the lost fat cats, they want to control you that you don't come into abundance, because you can't control a man that has money. You can't control a woman that has money. And God wants to see to it that you, in your lifetime, in this nation, that you are a people with exceeding abundance above all you can ask or think. And I'll tell you what, there's not another place in this city, that has taken the common everyday person and trying to teach them how to come into exceeding abundantly above all you can ask or think. No matter what happens, whether your grandmother wants you to go over here with this poor uncle that has a church, don't go over there. You stay where the hot word is being taught, like in this house right here. Don't go off somewhere. Oh, well, you know, he really needs some help over there. Listen, if he needs help, God will help him. And if God won't help him, then just let him alone. But stay where the blessings are. Oh, please, I'm telling you, you'll get drawn away to some dead place. Don't let it happen to you. Now, here, look here. Reward motivation. It's in this book, 1 Samuel 17:24-26. And all the men of Israel, when they saw the man Goliath, fled from him and were sore afraid. And the men of Israel said, now, get the picture now. David is with these men. Now, you get the idea from some of the teaching and preaching you hear that David just stood up there. I'm not afraid of that giant. No, he ran off. Everybody ran. They ran and they hid. And the men of Israel said, have you seen this man that has come up surely to defy Israel? Is he come up? It shall be that the man which killeth him, the king shall enrich him with great riches and will give him his daughter and make his father's house free in Israel. David is behind the rock with these guys and says, what shall be done to this fella? Which princess, the pretty one or the ugly one? Who is that uncircumcised Philistine that dares to defy the armies of the living God? You can fight a giant if there's a reward. This is a reward-motivated book. Are you learning anything? Okay. You know, Jesus is the one who promised the hundredfold. It wasn't some theologian. It was Jesus himself. Mark 10:27-30. And Peter began to say unto them, Lord, we have left all and have followed thee. I mean, now here's somebody, Peter had given all. And he said, wait a minute, Lord, what about us? And then Jesus speaks. Not one of the apostles, not one of the prophets, but Jesus himself speaks. And listen, when he speaks, if he says something's out there, it's for you. It's for you. You don't have to take and get a theologian to try to tell you it was somebody else. It's for you. And Jesus answered and said to you, verily I say unto you, there is no man that hath left house or brethren or sisters, father, mother, wife, children, lands for my sake in the gospels, but he shall receive a hundredfold now in this time. And preachers are teaching that your reward is in heaven waiting for you. Child of God, that's a lie. God doesn't reward you in heaven. He rewards you right here on the earth. Right here on the earth. It's not in the sweet by and by. It's in the nasty now that he wants to bless you. And he said houses and lands with persecution. And in the world to come, eternal life. Yes, there's something out there in eternity. It's eternal life. But the prize, the wealth, the possessions, God wants to put it on you here. Here. You know, by the next time I come here, now I'm only 86, so I'm going to be coming back quite a bit. Yeah. Yeah, when I get old, I'll quit coming. But I'm telling you, I'm going to see some of you. One of the biggest problems you're going to have, get ready for this. You're not going to have a big enough parking lot. No, not going to be big enough parking lot. No, no. Some of you are going to have to be able to, you're going to have chauffeurs just drive you by and drop the car off and take off. Somebody's got to have a chauffeur. May as well be you. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Peter now Jesus is one who, let me move to another area right now. You know, the substitutionary atonement, let me move to that now. Substitutionary atonement, consider with me the primary benefits of the atonement. Number one, Jesus became sin for us so we could be made the righteousness of God. Okay? Now, 2 Corinthians 5:21, for he hath made him to be sin for us who know no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. So I received the reward when I heard that he would be sin for me and I could be righteousness in his place. I said, I'll take that. I want that. And I said, yes. And then Jesus became sick for us so that we might be healthy. Isaiah 53:4-5. Surely he hath borne our griefs and hath carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken and smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we're healed. Now, number one, he that knew no sin became sin that I could be righteous. Number two, he who knew no sickness became sick that I might be healthy. But then, watch this. And you can't let this go. This is part of the atonement. Jesus became poor that you might become rich. Now, that word rich, too, is not rich in blessings, not rich in this. It's rich in material benefits of this earth. You follow? People play games. Why don't they want their people to be rich? If the Bible says you can be rich, I want someone to tell me I can be rich. not tell me that I'm going to get blessings. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. And that word is plutos, and it means rich in physical benefits. Are you grasping that? Now, where do we go from that? They put a crown of thorns on Jesus' head. They put a crown of thorns on his head. Genesis 3, 17 through 18. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat it of all the days of thy life. Thorns and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herbs of the field. Child of God, when they crucified our Lord, they beat him, but then they put a crown of thorns on his head. Why did they put the crown of thorns on his head? He was the king. He became the king of poverty. They crowned him the king of poverty so you would not have to go through poverty. Just like you don't have to go through sin, he died for your sins. Just because you don't have to go through sickness, by his stripes you're healed. That same verse, that same truth stands. As they jammed the crown of thorns upon his head, he said, I'll be the king of poverty, that my people might be rich and have exceeding abundantly above all they can ask or think. Oh, child of God, are you grasping any of what I'm trying to say to you? Well, in the book of Mark, in Mark the 4th chapter, you read about a seed that can be put in the ground, and if it gets in good ground, it comes forth what? 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. And then it tells later, just a few verses on, it says, and by the way, the word of God has seed time power. It has harvest power. And he says, let me get my thoughts straight. He says, you can have that increase from God's word, from the seed. But then you see it in the farm and you see it in the pulpit, 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. But did you know that when money is put into an offering plate, God automatically gives it harvest power? He gives it harvest power. Now, I know that that's a little strange because not much is said about that. You pick up book after book after book, you don't read much about that. But watch with me, please, if you would. In 2 Corinthians 9, 6 through 11, 2 Corinthians 9, 6 through 11, God gives seed power to the money that's given into the offering plates. Now, please notice, if they take up an offering in the city and they say, we're going to give to the poor people, wonderful. God says, if you give to the poor, you've lent to God, and they give it back to you again. But he says, if you put money in an offering plate, something takes place. Something changes. It gets seed power. It gets the power of 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. That offering plate, child of God, let me say, I raised 5 kids out of that offering plate. I educated children out of that offering plate. I saw weddings paid for out of that offering plate. I saw finances come to the point now that all of my children will have an inheritance when the time comes. And it didn't come from smart business. And many of you will be in smart business. My business was to teach this word. And I can't have anything else that put me where I am except the very fact that God said, John, I'll multiply it to you. I'll multiply it to you. It's nothing clever about me. I'm not a clever guy. But I'm telling you, I was smart enough to see that if he could save my soul, as nasty as I was, he could save my soul. He could surely put finances in my pocket. It would be a sorry God that couldn't put finances in your pocket and then try to talk you into winning your soul. So now, where in the Bible does it tell us that our money in the offering plate has seed power? Hebrews 9, 6 through 11, and I'm reading from the Living Bible. The sixth verse. Remember this, if you give little, you will get little. A farmer, look at that, he's taken that offering and he's beginning to talk farm talk about it. A farmer who plants just a few seed will get only a small crop, but if he plants much, he will reap much. Every man must make up his own mind as to how much he should give. Don't force anyone to give more than they want, than he's ready, really wants to. For cheerful givers are the ones God prizes. God is able to make it up to you by giving you everything you need and more, so that it will not only be enough for your own needs, but plenty left over to give joyfully to others. It's as the scripture says, the godly man gives generously to the poor. His good deeds will be an honor to him forever. For God, who gives seed to the farmer to plant and later on good crops to harvest and eat, will give you more and more seed to plant and will make it to grow so that you can give away more and more fruit from your harvest. Yes, God will give you much so that you can give away much. Amen. Here's what I want to do tonight. I want to speak a hundredfold increase over your offering. You say, Brother John, what does that mean? Well, it means a lot to some people that have become wealthy. I have them travel. There's probably some people here today that have traveled from across Africa to be with me. Wherever I go, people come to because there's something happens when I pray. You say, is there something special about you, Brother John? Yes, there is. I'm anointed. I'm anointed. And if you're anointed, you're special. And I have a special anointing. My anointing is to speak the hundredfold and to have people have results. By the way, some of you will have increases already before we meet together again the next time. You'll have increases. You'll have increases. And you say, how can you say that? Well, every time I've said it, it's happened. Every place I go and teach, people say, come back, talk, say the hundredfold, speak the hundredfold. And I'm speaking it tonight in this place. And how do we do this, Pastor? Do we bring it forward? Do we? Yeah, if you have to give tonight and you want to be part of this, you make your covenant with God now as you make that seed. And please know, if you sow little, you're going to reap little. If you sow big, you're going to reap big. And you say, Brother John, are you sure? Well, let me say this. If you don't believe it, just watch. Someone else will have it happen to them, and then you could say, I was a witness. I saw it happen. But I want you to do this. If you have decision tonight that you want me to pray that prayer over you, and by the way, before you leave tonight, I'm going to put another envelope in your hand. I'm going to put an envelope in your hand. And tonight, we're going to bring the offerings forward. We're going to lay them right up on the, just somewhere on the platform. Just throw them right up here. Can you reach up here? Is this too tall for someone to reach? It's too tall here for someone to reach. Yeah. Well, we're going to need some music in the buckets. We're not going to use the buckets, honey. They're going to put them right up here on this platform. Just going to do it that way. And if you come right now, if that's you and you're going to have the blessing. Jay, you got something to say?
For those that are giving online, if you can, after you've sent that, bring your phone up and just touch it to the altar. Touch it to the altar as a contact point of faith.
Yes, and you're part of that offering. It's in. Many times people are making a phone, making a gift by phone, and people see you sitting there and they think, well, you're not participating. This is the time to participate because it's going to touch other people. And if you'll just make that move now and start towards this altar and lay it up here, I will speak that increase in just a few moments. You peaceful with everything, Pastor?
Yes.
Amen. Okay, you begin now and just bring it forward. Just bring it forward. Amen. Amen. Bring your offering forward and lay it down. Glory to God. Glory to God. Look out, devil. Look out. Look out. Something's happening, devil. Something's happening. Something's happening. Something's happening. Kubareha bareha rabase baraki arabababa. Ohiha barabaha bababa. Simaraka parabati barabababa. Holy, 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 holy. Holy, 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 holy. My God is worthy, He's mighty, to the pulling down of strongholds. Mighty, mighty God, mighty God. Do not be denied. Press on in. Holy, my God is holy. He's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy. My God is worthy. Holy, holy, holy. My God is worthy, he's worthy. Mighty, mighty, mighty God, mighty God, mighty God. Worthy, worthy, worthy. My God is worthy. He's mighty, he's mighty. He's worthy, he's mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. Mighty God, mighty God. Worthy, 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 worthy. It's already happening. It's already happening. Some of you are going to have your reward waiting you at the house. When you get to the house, there's going to be breakthrough already. When you get to the house, who can believe for it to happen that quick? God is ready to do it. God's ready to do it. Yeah, he's ready to do it. Amen. You just bring it, bring it, bring it forward, bring it forward. Oh, hala ba 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 ba. Kipura ma ra ba ra ba sa ba. Holy, 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 worthy. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Kipura ma ra ba ba ra ba ba ba. Holy, holy. My God is worthy, he's worthy. Mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. Mighty God, mighty God, mighty God.
And for those of you that are watching online, you might be watching this live, you might be watching this later. If this message is for you, this is your time to respond. There's going to be either a QR code on the screen or there's going to be a way that you can give right there. And don't miss this opportunity. Cool. Don't pass over this opportunity, because not all these opportunities come every
Hallelujah.
Day.
Hallelujah.
Even as this a young man told about his father who took advantage of that opportunity. Changed his life, changed his ministry. Let this be the moment that you ignite the release of miracles into your life. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
It's already happened for some of you. It's already happened for some of you. You reach into the spirit world and pull it down. It's happened. It's already happened for some of you. Holy, 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 holy. Yes, come ahead, son. Come on. Pastor, be up on the platform ready, please. Would you stand and extend your hands towards this altar? Identify with your offering. Identify with your offering. Father, I thank you there's more than enough. And in the strong name of Jesus, I speak that this is multiplied 30-fold, 60-fold, even 100-fold, and it comes rapidly. It comes rapidly into the hands of your children. I speak it in the strong name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Go ahead. Pastor. Amen. Thank you.
Lift your hands. Lift your hands. Let's thank God for wonderful time. Lift your hands. Let's thank God for a wonderful time. Lord, we thank you for your word. Thank you for what you've put in our hearts, what you've blessed our church with. Tonight, we are grateful to you for these seeds. Thank you for the blessing of 100-fold. Lord, we know you see the faith of everyone here tonight and what we've placed before you. We thank you that you died for our sins. You died for our sicknesses. And you died to remove poverty from our lives. Thank you for that blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Everyone standing right before you sit down. I just want to give you an opportunity to come to Jesus tonight if you don't know him. Like Brother John said, Jesus exchanged places with us so that the sin that we carry and the punishment that goes with it is exchanged with his life. And when he died, we can live. And today, maybe someone brought you to church. Maybe you came. Maybe you haven't been for a while. But I like what he said. Come home, backslider. God wants to bless you. God wants to change your life. And he says, if you will return to the Almighty will be your defense. You lay up gold like dust, like the stones of Ophir, and you shall have plenty of silver. God wants to change your life. You know, when God calls you to give your life to him, he's not calling you to a difficult life. He's calling you to a good life. And there are some people here today, God wants to turn your life around. He wants to take away sin. He wants to change your destination from hell to heaven. He wants to take away sickness from your life. He wants to take away poverty and difficulty from your life. He wants to transform your life completely. And I want everyone to just bow your heads and close your eyes with me. If you're here today, you want to give your heart to Jesus Christ. Pastor, please pray with me. I don't want to go home without making sure that I'm right with God, that my relationship with God is where it should be. I want you to lift up your right hand right where you're standing, upstairs, at the back, all over this place. Let's lift up your right hand high above your head. Say, I need Jesus. Pastor, please pray with me. Somebody invited you. Somebody called you. You came by yourself. Maybe you're a Christian, but you've gone far away from God. Lift up your right hand. Pastor, I need God to change my life. Anyone, lift up your right hand and just wave at me wherever you are. If you've waved your hand, I just want you to leave where you're sitting. Come all the way to the front. I saw one or two hands. Just leave wherever you're sitting. Come all the way to the front. I want to pray for you. Very quickly, please come. God wants to change your life. God wants to change your life. I was at a service just like this on a Friday night. I was 18 years old, and I lifted up my hand in a service just like this on a Friday night, and I came forward and I gave my heart to Jesus, and he changed my life. Anyone else, wherever you're sitting, grab your bag, your Bible, your phone, whatever you have, and just come all the way to the front. I just want to pray with you. Very quickly.
To Jesus, I
Church, why don't we sing while they come forward? Everybody singing, I surrender to Jesus.
To him I freely give.
I will ever. Surrender all. Those of you in front, I want you to pray this prayer with me. And everyone in the room, why don't we pray together? Say, Heavenly Father, come on, let me hear you. Heavenly Father, I come to you today just as I am. I am a sinner. Have mercy on me. Come into my heart. Be the master of my life. Say, Satan, I'll no longer serve you. I'll no longer follow you. From today, I belong to Jesus. From today, I'm born again. From today, I have a new life. Now say, Lord, please write my name in the book of life so that one day I come to heaven to be with you. I say, thank you, Lord, for loving me, for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. And everyone shouted, Amen. God bless you, my friends. God is going to change your life completely. Amen. Our pastor has a sign that says, follow me. I want you to do just that. Please go with her. You'll be right back with us in a second. We have a gift for you and a word for you, and I know your life will never be the same again. Come on, First Love Church, give God praise. Why don't we celebrate God's gift? Brother John Avanzini, thank you so much. We love you so much, and we're so excited to hear what God has for us. Amen. Please take your seats.
Hey, thanks for watching the First Love Church YouTube channel. If you enjoyed this message, click the subscribe button. That way, you don't miss out on a single message. Thanks again for watching, and don't forget to like, share, comment, and subscribe.